Former Health Secretary Esperanza Cabral took part in the virtual meeting of the House Committee tackling the COVID-19 crisis earlier this week. During the discussion, Dr. Cabral stressed the importance of protecting our frontliners. She's also pushing for better coordination and alignment of activities between private and public healthcare facilities. Dr. Cabral joins us now on our special coverage. Good evening to you, ma'am.
Good evening, Tony.
How are you doing tonight?
Good, thank you.
All right, we'll discuss, of course, the proposals that were taken up during the virtual meeting of the House Committee on the COVID-19 crisis. There are many proposals, I suppose, that were taken up during that virtual meeting. But from your perspective, one of the most important things that has to be attended to would be to protect the healthcare workers who are on the front lines of this battle themselves. In your view, are they getting the necessary support and protection that they deserve?
Unfortunately, not yet. I hope that soon they will get the necessary protection that they deserve. At the moment, almost 800 of our doctors, nurses, and other healthcare workers are already sick with or are persons under investigation and have been exposed to COVID. And if our healthcare workers get sick, then nobody's going to take care of the population. So we really have to take care of them.
Mm-hmm. And what do you propose should be given to them by way of making sure that they're adequately protected while they're treating COVID-19 patients?
It's very important that they have the proper personal protective equipment because COVID-19 is very infectious. And so we want to avoid their exposure even as they take care of these patients. Second is they need to be provided with ample tools with which to fight the infection. That means if they need ventilators for their patients, they should be able to provide this for their patients, all the medicines and IV fluids, oxygen that the patients need, because even if they are there, they cannot do very much unless they have the proper tools to use.
Mm-hmm. And right now, do you think, Dr. Cabral, that those tools are being supplied or will be supplied in the short term?
Well, there have been surveys on how many ICU beds we have, for example, how many isolation beds we have, how many ventilators we have. And at the moment, we are not yet over capacity. So at the moment, I think we are able to provide for the tools that these healthcare workers need. But there may come a time when they won't be able to be provided with this. So we need to get ready for that.
Mm-hmm. And the other issue that you also brought up during the virtual meeting was the need for more proper coordination and alignment of activities of both public and private healthcare facilities. Why did you point that out during the meeting?
Well, in our country, we have a dual health system. 50% of our health system is public in nature and the other 50% is private in nature. And if you look at the data of COVID patients, 80% of them were actually taken care of in private hospitals. So it is not cheap to take care of these critical patients. So the private hospitals need to be compensated properly for their efforts. Apart from that, however, I think it is really a matter of the government, the public sector of the health system, and the private sector of the health system must talk to each other so that care of patients is seamless.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And how do you envision that to happen? Or how can you actually achieve that kind of communication between public and private healthcare facilities? Do you feel that, you know, it should be initiated by the public healthcare facilities?
Absolutely. It has to be initiated by the national government because they are the ones who regulate. They are the ones who provide technical assistance. They're the ones who compensate for the care given to private patients through the national health insurance system. They need to be able to agree with each other even after some debate, because there are always debates on things like this, on how and what it is they're going to do.
Mm-hmm. And give me an example, Dr. Cabral, of the kind of debates that you've been witness to. Because, I mean, you know, for lay people like us, we're hardly aware of, you know, the kind of maybe back and forth that medical practitioners are engaging in at a time like this when they're dealing with an outbreak.
Right. Well, take a look at the new case rates that PhilHealth is providing for the care of COVID patients. The case rates used to apply only to public hospitals, but this time they say that the case rates are going to apply to both public and private hospitals. What is going to happen is, unless the government says all COVID patients must go to the COVID wings that are accredited or to the COVID hospitals that are exclusively for them, the patients are going to go to the private hospitals because for the same amount of money, they're going to get what they perceive as better care. Hmm. In the meantime, the private hospitals are going to spend much more on these patients. They are not subsidized by government. The government did not buy their building. The government did not buy the materials and equipments that they are using. So their overhead is actually much bigger than the public hospital for which all of these things were provided by the national government. So there seems to be some distortion as far as the compensation is concerned.
Mm. When you say compensation for the medical facility
or treatment? Yes, care of patients. Ordinarily or previously, PhilHealth allowed co-payments because if a patient, for example, wants to go to a private hospital, the patient is going to pay above the rates that PhilHealth will pay for, and they're willing to do this.
Yeah.
But in terms of care for COVID patients, they said whether you go to a private hospital or to a public hospital, there can be no additional payments aside from what PhilHealth is going to provide.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, of course, you know, in our healthcare system, the reality is that people expect better service from a private healthcare facility than if you go to a government hospital, which is sadly the impression that most people have, that, you know, you go to a government hospital and you don't get as good a treatment as you do in a private hospital.
Yes. So what is going to happen is the patients are going to go to the private hospitals and overload the system.
Yes.
For the same amount of payment, they can get better care.
Mm-hmm. Of course, we're looking at an ideal situation where, you know, a patient wouldn't have to necessarily choose whether or not he'd get better treatment at a private hospital or at a public healthcare facility. And that should be something that should be happening throughout the country, that the quality of healthcare should be the same for public and private institutions.
That's correct. And I think that the national government is trying to do that. But at the moment, the impression is, as you said, you get better care in private hospitals.
Yes. And give us a little insight as to, you know, how much more discussion happening in the House committee to defeat COVID-19. How much more of these virtual discussions of the House committee will actually result in more concrete action to tackle this outbreak?
Well, the House of Representatives is a legislative body, so the information that they get from the discussions that we have are supposed to be so that they can make better laws. Okay, so at the meeting that I attended, I referred them to an act in the United States called the Defense Production Act.
Mm-hmm.
which is basically a law that says that during times of war, and let us consider this a war, really, the government should be able to tell private institutions to stop whatever they're doing and produce what is necessary to win the war. For example, we can look at those personal protective equipments. All we do is really buy. And when the world is in a situation like now, there is a pandemic, everybody's affected, everybody scrambles for this personal protective equipment, then we cannot get as much as we like. And as a result, we need to do it ourselves. Okay, so lots of households now, during their spare time, and they have plenty of that, are making makeshift masks, they're making makeshift gowns for the frontliners, because we do not have our own manufacturing of these things, and we do not have our own stockpile. And I think that is something that the legislators should consider. Mm-hmm. The other thing that I suggested to them is maybe to look into legislation for possible reserve medical corps. Much like the military has its reserve military corps, I think there should be some provision for doing the same thing for medical, for health workers, because when it comes to situations like this, it is very difficult if you don't have that.
A reserve medical corps, yes. Is that a unique idea, or are there other countries who are actually implementing that?
I'm sure many other countries are implementing it in one form or another, but these people, these doctors, go about their usual business, but they know that when the time comes that they are needed by government to do something, they have to respond to that call. It's very difficult in situations like this where you want to look for volunteers, and it's not so much what you pay for these people when they volunteer. It is the dignity. It is the realization that they're doing something good for their country. It is the preparation that is necessary, because this medical corps undergo regular training for disasters, for other medical outbreaks and things like those.
So when you talk about a reserve medical corps, are these people who don't necessarily have to be board passers, or do they actually have to have a professional license as doctors?
Yes, these are professional, these are licensed physicians that we are talking about. Mm-hmm. So that we do not have to use people who have not passed the boards as doctors.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I don't know how they'd be called reserve medical corps, because if they actually did pass the board already, then they'd be practicing physicians, wouldn't they?
Yes, they are practicing physicians, but then they can be called to service by the government.
Mm. Okay, and meaning to say they can be drafted, in a sense, to help in government hospitals.
Yes.
Mm. So, paano po yung kung kunwari, na nagtatrabaho na si doctor sa ilang hospital? Usually, a doctor has one or several hospitals that they have clinics in. Kakayanin pa ba nila to actually render service to a government hospital when they're drafted into it, or they'll have to drop all their private practices? And
yes, they have to do that. They will have to sacrifice their private practice in order to respond to the call of government. So, for example, if you are an infectious disease specialist and you are needed in a COVID hospital, you will have to be called to that hospital.
Yeah. Magkano po ang bayad doon? 500 pesos din a day?
Hindi naman. It's not the compensation that we are talking about. But
okay.
We need to give them some dignity and some recognition for what we do.
And of course, adequate protection.
Absolutely. That is the main thing.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Cabral, have they scheduled another virtual meeting in which you will be taking part in the House of Representatives?
I have no idea yet.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure they will call if they need me.
Okay. You'll be ready to actually give your inputs to them. Just on a closing note, in your medical experience, I'm pretty sure you've never experienced anything on the magnitude of this COVID-19 pandemic. How do you feel that the government health system is coping with it? And what lessons, apart from the proposals that you've mentioned, can we take away from this unique event?
Well, our doctors and other health workers, the Department of Health, they're all trying their best. But they're coming from a system that has limited resources. So they cannot provide for everything necessary. It's just that we are all trying and we must all help them.
Mm. All right. Former Health Secretary Esperanza Cabral, thank you very much, Dr. Cabral, for joining us on our special coverage. And we wish you well. Please stay safe and healthy.
Thank you, Tony. Good night.
Good night.